Last Sunday, we still gather on the first day of the week to commemorate the risen Savior and the fact that we serve a Christ who is living and well and who is sitting at the right hand of the Father even this morning. Will there be anyone who has a word of praise this morning? Anything that the Lord was good to you this week and you want to share about that today?
About a year ago, I had a situation that the Lord was still very good, but came out a little differently than this trip did, thank the Lord. And so that makes me more conscious of His goodness and safety in traveling, and also for the benefits of the convention. We're thankful for all of that.
All right, would there be any needs, any prayer requests, anyone has on the heart they want to mention this morning?
I had heard that Brother Bill Tellis has some heart issue. I don't know if he's still
okay
with us or not. I heard Bill's been.
All right. Let's remember him and the family.
We were praying for Brother John Walter, Lipnikoff's father. He did have three stents put in down in Atlanta. Linda and her sister and brother-in-law went down to be with him, but they brought him back this week, I think on Wednesday or Thursday, and he seems to be doing pretty well. So
okay, good. We can continue to remember the unsaved that we know of in our community and our families, acquaintances, that the Lord would be faithful to them and continue to draw souls to Himself. All right, I've asked Brother McDowell to open the class with prayer this morning. Let's pray together as he leads.
We do thank you, Lord. You are
the same yesterday, today, and forever. So as Brian mentioned, the date we observe as Easter is past for this year, but the truth of Easter, the reality of your resurrection and living forevermore and ascending on high and sitting at the right hand of the Father to ever live to make intercession for us, that's all just as true as it has been since the very first Easter and the time thereafter. We thank you and praise you. Help us to live the resurrected life with you and to live in the power of your resurrection, the power of your Spirit. We need you moment by moment to be able to do that, but you are alive and well and faithful. We praise you. We thank you for the blessings you have given each one of us this week. That we are here is a great blessing. And as I mentioned, we specifically or personally thank you for the safety in our trip and for our pastor's family and the many others. We haven't heard of any tragedies going or coming from the conventions. And we thank you for the spiritual blessings and all the connections and networking and fellowship that went on during that time. We thank you also for your help in the Clough family and the Walter family. And I pray you would continue to give grace and strength to all those involved there. Do pray for Brother Tillis. You know the details that we don't know, but pray you'd be near. I guess, at least I, being very human, have a hard time feeling the urgency quite as much as those who are very close until it is my own situation where the need is, and then I want people to remember and to pray urgently for me and for us. And so I do pray that you would be near to the Tillises and all of the connections there, all the ones who are close and who care. Thank you for the life of Brother Tillis and the way you've used him. Now, Lord, I'm sure there are many other requests represented here, the Stroops band. Thank you that Fritz and Patty are here, but be near to them. Brother Webb is not here. Be near to him, we pray. Susie and so many others we could mention, but thank you that you know them all. And then we pray for Brian. Thank you for the way you use him in this particular context, as well as others in the youth group. We pray you bless him and help him as he prepares for tonight. But right now, would you just give him a special touch from you, your spirit working through him, and if it could please you, help him to sense it. We know sometimes we don't sense it in the moment, and maybe never do, but still you can be doing your work. But it's so special when you let us know that you are indeed with us and working through us. So we pray, would ask for that favor this morning on Brian, and help us to be good, attentive listeners, and then, Lord, do lead us in the doing of your word, and not only the hearing. In Jesus' name.
The title of this morning's lesson is Christians and Money, and the key verse is found in 1 Timothy 6:10. And it's a familiar verse to us. I'm sure we've heard it from time to time. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith. And the central truth is biblical stewardship recognizes that all our possessions belong to God. And we'll read the scripture passage. If you don't have a quarterly or a leaflet, it's found in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 to 21. 1 Timothy chapter 6, beginning with verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou wert also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall show who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, whom no man hath seen nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. Amen. Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy, that they do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings, and oppositions of science falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. Grace be with thee. Amen. Well, the beginning of the scripture passage seems to break in the middle of a thought as the first sentence starts with a conjunction. I'll reach back to my least favorite subject in school, which was English and grammar and writing and all that stuff that I really chafed against doing. And here we are having to use it just like my English teacher predicted that we all would, and I didn't think we would. But that's a rabbit trail. It starts out, but godliness with contentment is great gain. So if we back up just a bit into the previous verses, we see that there was a type of person who Paul was referring to. And those verses go this way, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such withdraw thyself. So those are the verses that lead up right into the passage that we'll be looking at. That's why it starts out, but godliness with contentment is great gain. In contrast to those who held the belief that, well, if you had a lot, if you were pursuing a lot and could kind of amass some wealth, that, well, apparently God was favoring you or in the fact that you had those things that made you godly. It is not a good group of people who believes that prosperity is somehow a gauge of one's godliness. You see how these people went about with all this strife and this envy and these railings and trying to, seems like someone who's always stirring the pot. And those were the ones who thought that gain was godliness. And so we should do all that we can to keep ourselves from straying towards that way of thinking. The first verse in our lesson tells us that godliness with contentment is great gain. This other group of people have the equation upside down or backwards or both. They think that your godliness is realized through what you have or can accrue, when actually the greatest asset that we could have is to first have godliness and couple with it contentment. That is the truest, greatest gain. True religion, united with the proper accompaniment, peace of mind, can be regarded as true riches. So our first point in the lesson is a command, actually, and it tells us to avoid materialism. Well, do we know what materialism is? We have to know what we're avoiding. If someone tells us to avoid something and we don't know exactly what they're talking about, it's good to know. Well, kind of boiled down definition of materialism is a tendency to consider material possessions and physical comfort as more important than spiritual values. Now, I would think that, you know, I'm in pretty good company this morning, and I think it's safe to assume that none of us here would say that we are materialists. We wouldn't say that we consider our earthly possessions and comfort as more important than spiritual matters. But how close of a contest is it between the two? Are we more wrapped up in the things of earth than the things of heaven? Now, God placed us on earth, okay, so we have to live here at the moment. So therefore, we do have a mundane element in our lives. But where do our true desires, our greatest desires, lie? I think this passage is more about the attitude of our heart than it is the size of our bank account, although one may influence the other. Paul writes in verse 7 that we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. So when the stork dropped us off at the hospital nursery, you know, it didn't drop off a suitcase or a backpack with us that had some possessions with us to kind of get us jump started in life. And at the other end of life, you know, they say that hearses don't have trailer hitches. I mean, there may be some that are decommissioned that have trailer hitches, but you don't normally see a hearse pulling a trailer or one with some luggage on top. Because when you leave this world, you know, we break even. You can take what you brought with you, which obviously is nothing. Physically, we only take as much as we brought. If we are going to leave it all, why should we spend so much of our time and energy gathering what we cannot keep, and then go to meet a God who has an entirely different standard of success, I always kind of put that in quotes when I talk about success in spiritual matters. But you know what I'm referring to, a standard of success, than the one that we pursued all our lives. And slightly jocular anecdote, there was a rich old man, obviously this is not a true account as far as I know. There was this rich old man who was nearing the end of his life, and he was visited by this angel, and the angel told him that, well, just for him, they were going to allow him to bring one earthly possession with him when he came to heaven. So as he was coming to the end of his days, he packed a suitcase with his gold bars. He kind of boiled everything he had down, and that was his nearest and dearest possession, and he packed his suitcase with gold bars. And on his passing, he arrives at the pearly gates, and he's met by an angel, and he wanted to see what he had brought to the heavenly city. And so he opens the suitcase, and the angel looks in there, and he's kind of puzzled. He's like, pavement? You know, why did you bring pavement? That's what it would look like if we tried to bring anything from this world, you know, our greatest accomplishment, even if it wasn't a physical thing that we could carry through the gates of heaven. If it was some earthly accomplishment that was the pinnacle of our life's work, and we kind of wanted to bear that to heaven, it would look as dim and as useless as carrying some earth-grade gold into heaven. So we take nothing of this world's goods with us, and even if we could, they would look probably dull and shabby compared to the beauty of heaven. And I don't just mean the physical beauty of the streets of gold and the foundations of the precious stone and the crystal sea and those sorts of things, but I mean the glory and the holiness of the place because of He who dwells there. Paul further states that if we have food and raiment, we should therewith be content. So this represents our basic human needs. It doesn't mean, all right, if you have clothes on your back and some food for today, and you don't have a car and you don't have a house and you have no other earthly possessions, that's how you have to follow the scripture. That's what Paul is saying. Like, divest yourself of everything else earthly that you have except for the clothes on your back and provision for today's food. It's referring to what we would think is our basic human needs. Obviously, we all have, we need some place to live. I don't think anybody lives in a cardboard box or, you know, pushes around a shopping cart with all their earthly possessions in it. We have some place to reside. We have some place for shelter. It doesn't mean that if we have more than this, the basic necessities, that we're living in disobedience to God's word. It means that we should be satisfied with just having those needs met and shouldn't be clamoring or murmuring for more and better. And if we think that's too extreme, Jesus himself taught that we shouldn't give anxious thought about what to wear or what to eat. He said that our Father knows that we have need of those things. But what are we to do? We are to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto us. God will take care of the rest. He never has and never will forsake his righteous. Jesus also gave the parable of the rich man whose ground brought forth plentifully, and he thought to himself, what am I going to do? You know, I have this overabundance, and the barns and the silos are full, the sheds are full. What am I going to do? Because I had a bumper crop last year, and now this year's coming on strong. You know what I got to do? I got to tear these barns down. I got to rework the property. Got to build bigger, better. And God called him a fool. Now, it wasn't because he was enterprising, and it wasn't because he had wealth. We look at the patriarchs in the Bible. God blessed them with flocks and herds and maidservants and men servants, and you look at Job, how wealthy he was. Look at Abraham. Look how God blessed Jacob. Throughout Scripture, there have been wealthy people. The problem with this man was that he was not rich toward God. So what he was dealing with was completely temporal. He was looking, I'm going to tear down my barns for my bounty, so that I have a name here on earth, as it were. God said, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that layeth up treasure for himself, like the rich man, and is not rich toward God. His thoughts and his desires and plans were all on earthly things, and no regard was given to the things of God. Now the parable was about a rich man, and we read about the rich young ruler who came to Jesus asking, you know, what must I do to have eternal life? And he goes away sad because he had great possessions. We think, well, it's because he had great possessions and he couldn't give them up. Yes, but once again, it was a matter of the heart. It wasn't solely because he was wealthy. He went away sorrowfully because he had great possessions, but poor and middle-class people aren't exempt from the warnings in the Scripture. You know, just because someone may not have much money doesn't mean that they don't love it much. In verse 9, he cautions that they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, into many foolish and hurtful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. The desire to have money and possessions exposes men to unexpected temptations and traps them in unwanted trials and adversities. Part of the problem of amassing wealth is that it creates endless possibilities and therefore breeds many other desires for all kinds of worthless and harmful things. Things that we do not need and that we should not want begin to overwhelm our lives, saturate our minds, and absorb our time. All these things converge to overwhelm the soul and sink men down into spiritual ruin and eternal damnation. Those that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare. But another similar translation of this verse is that those who will to be rich fall into temptation. So it's not just the amount of money that we can scrape together that is the problem. It's also the desire that we have for it. When we desire to be rich, there are temptations and snares on the way there, as well as once we have arrived. So around us on a personal level, you hear of maybe shady business deals or misrepresentation or deception, and sometimes straight up theft. All because people are after a little more money. And on a larger scale, you know, in the news we hear about embezzlement and fraud and insider trading and political corruption. All for what? All for the love of money. The love of money is the root of all evil, not the money itself. People will do almost anything, even unspeakable evil, for the right amount of money. And we can look out there at, you know, all the bad examples in the world, the human traffickers, the drug dealers, the white-collar criminals, and say, yes, definitely the love of money is the root of all evil. But if we look at the second half of verse 10, it doesn't really sound like Paul is talking about people that are out there. Paul is talking about people who have erred from the faith. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some come after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. So wait, like Paul's talking about believers, like Christians, people who had been at the church and, you know, in the church at one time? I'm afraid he is. There were and are people whose love of money and longing for possessions has caused them to stray away from their personal faith. Their first love has grown cold because they are now worshiping another god. And I call it a god with a little g, because there is power in money. That's why people, one of the reasons people crave is not just so you have a larger bank account than the next guy. A lot of times that is the bragging right. Whose net worth is the most today? Let's Google and see who's top dog as far as the things that are reported. But there's power in wealth. You can get things quicker. you can, you know, medical treatments, you want to live longer, you want to be treated in a nicer way, you just pay people, you throw money around, you snap your finger and things happen because money's no issue. And people are willing to do things for you because they, in turn, want their piece of the pie. So there is a power to this God that people worship. That is why we have scriptures like this warning against it. I mentioned that people will do anything for the right price, and unfortunately, Christians are not exempt from the bargaining table. We might not be called upon to break the law, but what about matters of ethics and conscience and obeying the dealings and guidance of the Holy Spirit? So on the surface, perhaps no one knows how much of our godliness we have traded for gain, and we may have walked away from a deal or a situation richer in the things of earth, but we are now poorer by heaven's standards. Again, this love of money is a heart issue, regardless of the amounts involved. This caution from the word isn't just for those out there, but for us in here. And I don't think any of us want to find ourselves in this situation. So how can we, in contrast to the man who planned to tear down and build greater, how can we, unlike him, be rich toward God? Well, that leads us to our next verse and to our next step, to our next next section. Verse 11 tells us we are to flee all the things we just described. So the love of money and probably some of the things that were mentioned even before the passage that we're looking at as far as the strife and those sorts of things. And instead, we're to follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and meekness. So there are things on earth to be desired, healthy things, but there are some things that if there is a void, as it were, in our spiritual life, that they will be filled with the wrong things. This passage here gives us plenty of things to follow after, to pursue, to chase, to desire, in order that some of those other desires, like the love of money, won't be as much of a temptation for us. We're furthermore instructed to fight the good fight of faith and to lay hold on eternal life. Through our Christian journey, although we are granted God's peace, presence, and power, we are engaged in battle. We should never think that we can just coast along the pathway to heaven. Now, I understand, because I've experienced it, and I'm sure many of, if not all of us have, there are times where it is kind of a plateau, where it doesn't seem like we're not really running flat out, we're not meeting much resistance, but we're plodding along. But even in those times, we must remember that there is an enemy of our soul who is seeking to destroy us. This walk takes effort, it takes endurance, and it takes perseverance. When the verse says to lay hold on eternal life, it gives the idea that it isn't something we dare be half-hearted about. Lay hold on eternal life. Our making it to heaven won't happen by accident. Paul reaffirms the necessity of following what he has just written. He charges Timothy before God to keep the commandment, which he has given, which is basically verses 11 and 12, where he gives the things that we're supposed to follow after and we're supposed to fight the good fight and to lay hold on eternal life. He charges Timothy before God to keep those things without spot and rebukable until Christ's return. And what an astounding appearance that will be. You know, I was looking for the right word there. You know, we think glorious, and it will be glorious. It will be amazing. That's awesome. That's kind of overused as well. And I was like, man, I mean, we'll be awestruck. And I think even as Christians, I know the world will be astounded at his appearing. But even as Christians, I think it'll be so much to take in at his appearing. How foolish would we be to trade our pursuit of his riches for the pleasures and comforts of earth? May we always bear in mind the glory and the power of the one we serve. May we not be ashamed at his coming. May he say to each of us, well done. You have handled faithfully what I've entrusted you spiritually and physically. In the final section of our lesson, which is another command for us to follow, is to use riches rightly. In this final part, we see more evidence that the amount of wealth that a person has or doesn't have, you know, it doesn't make a person automatically godly or ungodly. Like, there isn't some threshold like, well, you have to stay under this net amount for God to like you. It's not like that. Paul gives instruction directed to people who have money. And again, this doesn't seem directed to, you know, the 1% of wealth holders out there. It pertains to the church. It pertains to our circles. And though we may not consider ourselves rich in this world's goods, the teaching is applicable to everyone and anyone. So he instructs them not to be high-minded. You know, we shouldn't be haughty or dressed to impress for show or for status. And again, it's not just rich people who are guilty of this. There are some very poor people, if they can just get a certain brand or a certain name on their shoes or a certain style, a certain hat, a certain handbag, if they can go to a certain place on vacation and blow it up on social media, then, you know, that's something. Be not high-minded. You know, I've seen some people take as much pride in their rust bucket as some people do in their Porsche. I've met some businessmen who that's kind of like their daily driver. And we're like, oh man, you know, can I sneak a picture of it? And he's just like, yeah, you know, I had the wife's in for service and they gave me this as a loaner and I just like this and so much I traded hers in and this is what I'm driving. And we're like, yeah, all right, you know, right on. And they don't really flaunt it, you know, like they don't try to be flashy with it. Now there are some people who do just the opposite and they are there to be seen. But then there are people who have some, you know, some older rust buckets, but man, it's like they shine what isn't rust. And they, you know, they're just proud of their baby that they've got. Be not high-minded. Be not haughty. However, there are some things that only wealthy people can afford. So they are cautioned not to pursue a manner of life that would make others feel uncomfortable or feel less around them. Our blessings, great or small, come from God. So it's not our business to be flaunting them. You know, there's a saying that goes around, if daddy bought it, it doesn't count. You know, so when people, you see somebody roll up in a really nice car and it's like, they didn't buy that, you know, that's in their dad's name. It's like, and you want to come out here and be like, oh yeah, look at my car. It's like, that's your dad's car, like chill. God entrusts us with things and we should be like, well, look what God gave me. Be not high-minded. Don't trust in the uncertainty of riches. Though it doesn't matter if it's 5,000 or 500,000, we are never to put our trust in money. And I'm sure right now there are a lot of people who are realizing the uncertainty of riches, whether it's, you know, whether they're invested in digital currency or whatever holdings they've had in the past. Now it's like, well, what about the dollar? What about, you know, what about Bitcoin? What about this? You know, what's the stock market going to do tomorrow? Trust not in the uncertainty of riches. Don't trust riches. Trust the one who placed you in charge of them. We should do good, that we should be rich in good works. Here's how we can all be wealthy towards God. And this is by doing good, especially to those who are of the household of faith. The central truth of this lesson was, biblical stewardship recognizes that our possessions belong to God, and I don't have a whiteboard with me this morning, so you have to bear with me. I have to work something up. It's just kind of a visual aid. Sometimes I think we get the, well, you'll see where I'm going in a moment. So I'd used this some time ago, and it kind of came to the surface a while back. So let's say that this is our net worth right here. And we're gonna do a pie chart, because those are more fun than grammar and spelling and all that stuff. So let's say that this is our net. Maybe this is our budget for the year, for the week, whatever it is. And we have to dice it up, and we have to see how much we spend on ourselves and how much we spend on God. And we're going to look at it and be like, well, you know, am I really looking at the things of earth? Or am I serving God? And am I really being a wise steward of what he's given me? So right off the top, even before you get your check, unless you're self-employed, Uncle Sam comes along and he's like, oh, you thought. And so there goes a big chunk of it. And then you have to pay rent or a mortgage. So there goes a big chunk of it. You have to pay insurance on your house and your car. And you might have some student debt you have to pay off. And you have to buy food. And am I missing anything? What else is out there? Medical bills, life insurance, fuel, yeah, yup. Car insurance. Yeah, they're due Tuesday, just saying. Yeah. So, well, I guess we better chisel out at least 10% here. Get that to God. I don't know. I guess we'll call this one God's money down here. So, are you laying up riches in heaven? I mean, how's it going down here with God's money? How's that stacking up? Well, the problem is where we put the label. Because really, if I can do this right. Actually, all of it's God's money. We're just in charge of it. But with that comes responsibility. So it's not like, well, it's God's money and he wants me to live happy and he does wants us to have a joyous existence. But we can't just be like, well, it's God, so I'm gonna throw it around. We have a responsibility to steward it well. And we should be making wise choices with it, because it is God's money. It's not really ours. Like I said, God entrusted it to us. So every decision that we make, I'm not saying you have to pray over buying a Mountain Dew. I'd be saying lots of prayers along that way if that was my case. But if you're making, you know, if you're going to make a significant purchase, remember that it's not like, well, I put in this overtime, I saved up for this, I'm going to buy it. No, God allowed you to have that job. He gave you the strength to get there. And he gave you the strength to put in the money, to put in the labor to get that money. And is that a wise use of his money? Or are you going to honor him with that, you know, gun you're going to add to your collection? You know, just being real transparent. Or does God want you to use his money some other way? Now, don't, you know, that was just a personal example.